Good morning. My name is David Clarkson and I'm the minister at Barclay View for Church. I want to welcome you to our time together today, wherever you are watching us from. You're very welcome. If you are watching on YouTube or Facebook, then we would encourage you to try the church online platform, and there's a link for it on the screen. It's really because that platform allows a little bit more interaction between folks who are watching the service. We have hosts who can help you, who can answer questions, who will post other links to Zoom meetings and so on, and you can get them there really quite easily. It also helps folk to feel a bit more engaged with the service as it's going on. When you get there, you'll find it down at the right-hand side. There's a box, and hopefully people will be in there chatting as we approach the service time. There's a few minutes before and a few minutes after for folks to do that. And then during the service, folks respond as it's going on. So have a think about it if you don't already use that on Sundays. Over these next few weeks, 2 weeks today, we're starting a series on the Lord's Prayer. And to run alongside that, we are going to be doing a prayer course. And prayer is really important. We've come to this point in the year and we're still in lockdown, and they're actually beginning to make the lockdown ever more difficult. And so we want to be asking questions about what God is doing and saying to us as a congregation in this time. And we also want to pray for other people as well as each other. So prayer is important. And I want to encourage you to sign up for the prayer course. And I want to also encourage you to think, as we go through each section of the Lord's Prayer, what does it mean for me? And then at the end of that, from the Saturday into Palm Sunday, so that's the 27th into the 28th of March, we're going to do 24 hours of prayer. And our hope is that somebody, one person at least, hopefully more, will sign up for every single one of those 24 hours. And you might say to yourself, oh, praying for an hour, how on earth would I do that? Well, when we started this, when I was minister in Prestwick, that was quite a common question. How could I do that? And many of us who have been folk who have prayed for years thought the same. But actually, what we discovered was there are things that, activities, there are books, there are all sorts of things that can help us to pray for that time. And what we discovered was folk who came for the first time to our prayer room often went away saying an hour wasn't enough. And so I would encourage you to sign up for that and to consider it and to come and pray. You don't need to have access to the internet for it. You'll be able just to take an hour. And because it's online, we're praying in our own homes anyway. So as long as we know, we would like you to let us know if you're going to pray in your home. And you don't need to be online. You don't need to have online access. Just let us know and we'll add your name so that we know that there's people covering that hour. And that would be really helpful for us. And it'll be a real blessing for you and for those folks for whom you pray and for the circumstances you pray for. And so I would encourage you to join in with that. I'm going to hand over now the service to Elaine, who is our pastoral associate.
Good morning, everyone. It's great that you have been able to join us for worship today so that we can be together as a church family. And I look forward to sharing this service with you. But first of all, I have another wee advert. You'll see from our website that Barclay View Forth Church has a number of groups which aim to do life together, even if it remains online at the moment. And they hope to share the good news of Jesus. These groups, along with the other ministries in the church, usually meet together twice a year to share stories of what they've been doing and to have time to plan together and pray together. This is called a learning community. Our last learning community took place last February before lockdown. And now that we've mastered the technology required so that we can all meet together, we hope to gather again on Zoom on Saturday, the 6th of February, from 10 till 12. We hope that members of our groups will join us. But even if you're not involved in any of the groups, or even if you want to just find out a little bit more, can we invite you to join us that morning just to see what we get up to and see where maybe you are being called to serve? For more information on this, please contact Julie, our church administrator, and her email address is just appearing now. So, at the start of this service, let's pause for a moment to still our rushing minds and focus our eyes on God. Let's think of the words of Psalm 100, which is subtitled, A Psalm for Giving Grateful Praise. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that your love endures forever and your faithfulness continues through all generations. We acknowledge that lockdown might be putting tremendous strain and pressure on us in different ways. But we are grateful for the new ways we have found to share in worshipping you together. We pray for those who are unable to participate in this way and ask that you would draw close to them this day. And now, Lord, hear us as we say the words Jesus taught us to pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. Our opening song is one that's well known to us, but one which calls us to prepare for Jesus' return. And then following the song, we say hi to Stephanie as she leads us in Kingdom Kids. In the meantime, let's sing These Are the Days of Elijah.
Righteousness being restored, and all these are days. So we are at the point in the story of the New Testament. Jesus just got dunked into the water, what we call baptism, in the River Jordan, and is now on his way into the desert. It's a weird spot going into the desert. But here's the thing, before Jesus would go on with this new path that laid out before him, telling people about God wanting to live with him, preaching to them, healing them, being there for them 24/7, that means day and night, he needed time with God. And so he went into the desert and prayed. And during this time, a rather unpleasant surprise was waiting for him. The liar, the one that likes to twist the truth around. The snake, as we met this liar with Adam and Eve. This liar was waiting for him in the desert, and he showed Jesus wonderful plans to avoid going the difficult path, to avoid being there for us, to avoid fulfilling God's plans. And the message Jesus said was this: it is more important to keep to God, to be in this relationship with God, than everything you offer. Riches, water to quench my thirst, even the easy way around the difficulty that is ahead. It is more important to live in a good relationship with God, or in this relationship with God. What Jesus reminds us of is that God is there. And no matter what difficult is ahead, God is with him each step of the way. And this is what we take from this story for us, where we are part of God's story. Because that promise also is to you and to me. And now, with this in mind, we sing together. I go anywhere, anywhere you go, as long as I'm with you.
I'll go anywhere, anywhere at all, as long as I'm with you. I'll go anywhere, anywhere you call me to, as long as I'm with you. As long as I'm with you. You're the adventure of a lifetime, Jesus. You take my heart and make it wild. You are the thrill my soul is seeking, Jesus. Your grace has no horizon line. Your grace has no horizon line. I'll go anywhere, anywhere at all, as long as I'm with you. I'll go anywhere, anywhere you call me to, as long as I'm with you. As long as I'm with you. Take me out beyond the waves, Lord Jesus. You are the captain of my soul. There is no map of where your wild heart takes us. We're running into the unknown. We're running into the unknown. I'll go anywhere, anywhere at all, as long as I'm with you. I'll go anywhere, anywhere you call me to, as long as I'm with you. As long as I'm with you. I'll go anywhere, anywhere at all, as as long as I'm with you. I'll go anywhere, anywhere you call me to, as long as I'm with you, as long as I'm with you. Today's reading is taken from Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, beginning at verse 14. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Amen.
Thank you, Sheila, for reading for us today. So, as many of you know, my husband Chris is a keen fisherman. Several times a year I become a fishing widow as he sets off for a day, a weekend or a week to go with his friend to different parts of the country to enjoy their hobby. Sometimes they catch fish, and sometimes they catch the cold. However, this is just a hobby for them, unlike the many boats which leave our harbours around our coastline every evening, where the people on board catch fish for a living. It's not an easy job, with fishermen often battling the elements, risking life and limb. Our fishermen in today's reading faced many similar challenges, and we can read in scripture in various places of the tempestuous weather which would often hamper their work. It's to this that our main protagonists have been born, but their lives were about to change forever. We heard from Stephanie that Jesus, after his baptism, spent some time in the desert, a place of retreat, so that he could pray, spending time with his Heavenly Father. But while he was there, he was tempted to stray from the path that was before him. But Jesus overcame. And having come through that temptation, Jesus then begins his ministry. But he knew he couldn't do it alone. He knew he had to call others to help. He needed them to help spread the good news of the kingdom of God. Now, he didn't just choose the church leaders of the time for this task. He chose ordinary people. Ordinary people. It's actually hard to believe that ordinary people were the leaders, the founders of our church that God rules. You just need to think of what President-elect Biden is doing at the moment, choosing people for important jobs in his government. But he's choosing the people who are best qualified for the role, as you might expect. But Jesus chose ordinary people. Perhaps because he feels we are qualified for the role. A few years ago at our evening services, we studied the individual call of each disciple using the book 12 Ordinary Men. And in working on that, I was amazed that the disciples were so ordinary, but they went on to do extraordinary things. Our fishermen had a hard life who, when they weren't out battling the elements, catching fish to sell so that they could feed themselves and pay their bills, then they were mending their boats and their nets. They always had work to do. Then Jesus came along and changed their lives. So if you look at John's Gospel in chapter 1, verses 35 to 42, we learn that Andrew was the first disciple called by Jesus. Let me read some of that to you now. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" And they said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and they saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him, and it was about 4 PM. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. So in the early days of the church, Andrew was called Protokletos, a Greek word which means first called. Initially, Andrew and Simon Peter had been disciples of John the Baptist, and because of his teachings, they knew that one day the Messiah would come. Once Andrew and Simon Peter knew that Jesus was the Messiah they had been waiting for, they had no hesitation in leaving everything to follow Jesus. And when Jesus said, "Come on, let's go, I will make you fishers of men," they just upped and went away. They left everything behind, no questions asked. They knew they had to answer the call to go. Now, that might seem a little bit strange to us, but over the years, we've heard of many great men and women who have answered that same call, leaving their ordinary lives behind and then gone on to serve God in extraordinary ways. Some, like the disciples, were martyred for that faith. Even the Lexio 365 daily Bible reading app spoke just last week of Jim Elliot, a young American missionary who was called to bring God's love to the Aucas people of Ecuador. He and his four companions were killed trying to do so, but his short ministry was so effective. His wife, Elizabeth, and some of the other relatives went down and actually lived among the Aucas people. And they came to faith. And some of the tribe people went on to serve in ministry. They grasped an understanding of what forgiveness is, of what Jesus forgave for us on that cross. You can read the story of Jim Elliot in the book Through Gates of Splendor, and I recommend it as a very good read. Closer to home, we've had people from our own church family who were called to serve overseas. Some of you may remember Irene Glass, who served in India, Eric Jeffrey, who and Aileen Robson, who both served in Malawi, Mike and Jane Fuchella, who were in Thailand, Una Laidley, who was in the Yemen, and Elspeth Patterson, who was in Asia. And just a few weeks ago, we heard from another young couple who hoped to move overseas in the coming months to serve God. They each were or have been called to leave their lives behind and to step out into the unknown. Step out into the unknown with Jesus leading the way. And like the fishermen in today's reading, they answered God's call. They put their trust in God for their provision, their health and their safety, and so much more. Now, if we're honest, how would we respond to such a call? I have to say, I might be a bit like the men in Luke 9 who wanted to go and do other things before answering the call. In verse 59, Jesus said to another man, "Follow me." But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Jesus said, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus said, no one who puts a hand to the plough and looks back is fit for the service of the kingdom of God. Now, we may not all be called to go and be missionaries overseas, but we are called to follow Jesus and serve God's kingdom right where we are. That is our missionary work. That is how we follow Jesus. I read a great quote on Twitter the other week from Pete Anderson, who is the pastor of Destiny Church. And it was the day before people were supposedly returning to work on the Monday. And he said, are you dreading going back to work tomorrow? Or eager to go back to the mission field where God has placed you? Now there's a challenge. Answering that call involves us having to say yes to loving God above all else, to serving God with our hearts, and to living lives that not only model Jesus in our words and our actions, but lives that will act as a beacon for those around us. Jesus wants us this day and every day. He is calling your name. Now, your name might not be Simon or Andrew, James or John, Bartholomew or Paul or Luke or Lydia or Mary, but Jesus knows your name. He is calling out to you with those same words he said to the disciples. Come, follow me. Let's go. Jesus uses ordinary people like us. He equips us to do extraordinary things, to bring people to the kingdom. Sometimes we might think that Jesus' call is not for us. After all, what would God want with someone like me? However, you only need to read the Bible to see that God calls the most ordinary, broken, weak people. I'm not saying that you're all ordinary, broken and weak, but a lot of us are. Eugene Peterson, in his book Run with Horses, refers to them as disappointingly non-heroic. Abraham lied. Jacob cheated. Moses murdered and complained. David committed adultery. Jonah ran away. Matthew was a tax collector who defrauded people. Peter blasphemed. And the list goes on. Jesus wants you, warts and all. His invitation to you is, come, follow me. And if your name is on that list of people who have done wrong, Jesus has already paid the price for you. He sacrificed his life that we might be forgiven and have life in all its fullness. It might be that there are some of you watching here and wondering if God is actually calling your name. You may not recognize the voice. You may not know how to respond. Alternatively, you may have become a Christian many years ago, but have lost that initial excitement of that first call, that excitement that you get with a first love. Or perhaps now is the time to rekindle that love for Jesus. Or you might be someone who is searching for something but haven't found the answers yet. And if that's not you, maybe you have a friend in one of those situations. But if it is you, if it is your friend, can I recommend that you join us as we explore the Alpha course together online? This 8-week course, which is widely advertised and you can read about it online, we're running one starting on Thursday, the 28th of January at 7:30. will provide a safe space to learn more about faith, about Jesus, and to ask those questions that you've been harbouring for years. If you would like to join us, drop Julie an email. We would love to see you. And by the way, even if you don't fit into any of those categories, Alpha is about exploring faith together. It's a place to ask questions and hopefully have them answered. David is very good at answering questions. Just ask the folks on the last Alpha course in the autumn. So pause for a moment. Do you still wonder if Jesus is calling you? Listen for his words. Come, follow me. Answering yes to that call every day will change your life forever. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you that you speak to us as individuals and that you call us to serve your kingdom. Help us to be ready every day to answer your call so that we might be fishers of men. Help us to continue to live by Jesus' example and keep us faithful in praying for family, friends or colleagues who have yet to know you so that they too might share in your blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. John is now going to lead us in our prayers for others before we sing the song Purify My Heart and dedicating our lives anew to Jesus.
Let us pray. Father God, we trust you as a good father who is our refuge in times of trouble, remembering your care for those who trust in you. In these difficult times, we pray for all who are affected by coronavirus through illness or isolation or anxiety, that they may find relief and recovery. We pray for doctors, nurses, and medical researchers that through their skill and insights, many will be restored to health. And we remember those now involved in delivering the vaccination programme, that they may be effective in bringing protection to the most vulnerable. We pray that the practical arrangements may run efficiently and smoothly. We thank you for the hope that the vaccines bring for a return to a more normal way of life. Yet we are very aware this week of the difficulties we still need to go through, and we continue to ask your blessing on the vulnerable and the fearful, for the gravely ill and the dying, that they may know your comfort and peace. We remember those who are guiding our nation at this time and shaping national policies, that they may make wise decisions. And as we pray for our nation, we also remember this week the people of the United States with the inauguration of President Biden. We pray for peaceful transition and a healing of division. We think of those in the congregation who have recently suffered bereavement, asking your comfort for Elaine Dove and Linda Garside in their loss, and a knowledge of your presence as they attend the funerals of loved ones this week. We know a number of people from our fellowship who are in hospital or unwell at home. We entrust to your care those who are ill or in pain. Comfort and heal them and restore them to health and strength. In a moment of silence, we bring before you people and situations known to us. Finally, we pray for ourselves and this congregation. Help us to listen to your call in our lives, not allowing it to be crowded out by other voices or any fears we may have. Help us to be willing disciples following Jesus, learning from him and sharing his love and transforming message. Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Before we go, why not join us tonight on Zoom for our weekly prayer gathering at 7 o'clock? If you haven't joined us before, email me for a link. All are welcome. It's a very safe space and an opportunity to chat to folks as well and pray together. So as we leave to go about the rest of our day, let's pray. Lord, go before us, that we might follow wherever you lead. And now may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with each of us, now and forevermore. Amen. And have a good week, everyone. Oh.